George Harrison, what did he have to say? He was out here recently, apparently, and saw the show.
Yeah, he took us to dinner afterwards.
That was the biggest thrill of my life, because I'm a Beatles freak, first and foremost.
Mark's knees were shaking under the table.
I was, seriously. You know, the story about Molly Meldrum fainting when he met John Lennon. Well, I nearly did the same thing. It was about. It was only about 6 weeks, 4 weeks ago.
And he snuck in, didn't he?
He was, and what happened was the producer of the film that we're about to do said, you know, George Harrison's here, no, John? I went, and you sort of thought to myself, who's also called George Harrison?
Yeah, yeah.
And then as I turned around, he was coming up and sort of took my hand and loved the show. You know. And then, of course, this one comes zooming up, and Ben says, Wendy, George Harrison. She didn't listen. And she went, hi.
Initially began as a drummer in your musical career, correct?
Yep.
How did you get that set of drums?
Actually, my mum sold some things, and just 1 week I went in and I said, I've got to be a drummer, you know, I really want to be a drummer, that's all I want to do. And she skipped the rent that week and gave me the money to go out, and I bought an old pool kit, and I was just lucky I was born talented and stuff.
I bet she's happy she did skip the rent for 1 week now.
She is now, she wants it back though.
Playmate of the year.
Does she walk? Does she talk? Does she come complete? My homeroom angel always pulled me from my seat. She was pure like snowflakes.
Beauties everywhere. Amanda Doll is another contestant. Darling, how are you? Are you the youngest girl?
Yeah, I'm the youngest contestant tonight and the youngest centerfold that Playboy's had.
Memory of my angel could never cause me pain. Years go by, I'm looking through a girly magazine.
There she is, Playmate of the Year for 1983, Amanda Doll. So did you meet Dire Straits before the story that goes like they had a tape around and a DJ picked
no,
it up and started
no, to the day, what happened was that the day that they were signed to Phonogram, the A&R guy who signed them was a guy called John Staines, who we affectionately call Stinker. He rang me up and he said, I got this great band. Dire Straits, and I said, what a terrible name.
Yeah.
But I was an agent then, I'd been an agent for 8 years, and I was looking for a support group for the Talking Heads, and the jock straps weren't available, so I got, I said that, you know, I might be interested in the Straits, and I went round to Phonogram and listened to this tape, which had got the Sultanas of Swinge on it, and Wild West End, and a song called Sacred Loving, which they never recorded, thank God, and Water of Love, and I remember when I was listening to Sultans, I thought, God, this guitar player's really good. He's like Hank Marvin on LSD.
Don't you enjoy seeing all these
exotic of course.
Places like this?
I mean, this is fantastic. I don't come into too many condemned buildings. But
yes, I have seen your show. I had a front row seat.
When did the first television?
The first television thing was actually shot in this very, very same place. And it was called Class of 74. I did walk around wearing seam stockings for a while. Oh, sorry, I shouldn't have said that. It's upset him.
No. I watch Benny Hill a lot.
It's not actually...
Englishmen have a terrible hang-up about that. Well, it's not a hang-up, really.
Seam stockings?
Yeah.
Well, we had a
problem.
Do
stop saying it, please.
We ran out.
talk about the Velvet Underground and when you first started that group and how it all came about, how innovative it was?
It never lived up to its promise. No. It took maybe about a couple of years to put the band together. Then to get to the point where we were ready to record. Mm-hmm. And between the time that we had all the material and the time that we met Andy, there was a little period there that we put a mixed media thing together.
Right.
The importance of the band was that it was part of a milieu in New York at the time. There was a very ferocious avant-garde atmosphere where everybody was running around being very busy and developing all sorts of film, video, radical filmmaking.
Yeah, yeah.
That involved Yoko Ono and Nam June Paik and a lot of people from Korea who were somewhat rabid Maoists in the political sense. Right. But all of this was thrown into a milieu of creating music, and somewhat along the line everything tended to get confused, and it was important to put music with visual scenes.
So what happened to Velvet Underground? What brought it all to an end, or was it just that you weren't going as quickly as you thought, or whatever?
Well, MGM kind of made a decision about where they were going to put their promotion money.
Yeah.
They said, okay, well, we got Frank Zappa and we've got the Velvet Underground. Velvet Underground has Andy Warhol. All that Frank Zappa has is us. And so we're not going to promote Velvet Underground.
Shock value of the Dead Kennedys. Are there things like, have you ever appeared on stage totally naked?
Yes, but not on purpose.
It just gets ripped off you, I've noticed.
Yeah, so we try to put a stop to that, because once we were opening for The Clash, and we'd never played before a large number of people before,
yeah.
And as an experiment, here was this soft bed of skulls in front of me, so I dove out into the crowd, like Iggy Pop and Darby Crash had done many years before, and who knows how many other people.
Right.
But I hadn't done it in that situation before, so I figured, why not? And away went my jeans, away went my shirt, and held onto my belt and my shoes and my Argyle socks, and that was about it. And so some people after that began showing up at our smaller club gigs thinking that they had come to see a striptease. And it was not as though I had any money to run out and buy new pants or new shirts or anything, so we just had to get into that.
Right.
Occasionally accidents do happen, but that's not really the main purpose of the performance or the band.
There have been three arrests, is that not correct, since you've been here in Australia?
There was a third one now.
Yeah, can you explain what they were for?
The first one, our drummer, who was black, was standing in a group of white people in Brisbane, in Queensland, with an unopened bottle of beer in his hand, and other people were drinking and stuff, and the cops pulled up, singled him out, and decided to take him away for drinking in public. And Ray, our guitarist, interceded, or tried to, and they took him away as well.
And what's the third one now?
The third one was our sound man coming into a hotel, asking for the key to his room, pointing out his name on the register, and the guy said, no, you're not registered here, and called the police to prove his point, and Chris, our sound man, asked to prove his point. Oh, resisting arrest, that's a $1,200 fine, gotcha.
Can you?
This was in Canberra.
Can you forgive Australia for that?
Sure.
Has the rest of it been good?
It's not as though everybody in Australia is like that.